the office bearers of the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association, my esteemed colleagues, former judges, law officers, senior counsels, and members of the bar. Last few minutes, I have listened with very rapt attention to what the attorney and the president of the bar had to say. I think the truth lies somewhere in between. It's not inadequacies and aberrations that make the system. As the Chief Justice designate, let me assure you, there's a lot to look ahead, a lot to look forward. The system has done well, in spite of odds. We have a whole lot of very committed judges, committed to the cause. And they will continue to be committed, regardless of the inadequacies in terms of remuneration, in spite of the possibilities of abuse of their names. We don't have to be alarmed with that. It comes with the system. But we are basically gathered here to commend an illustrious career that has spanned the high courts of Orissa, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Delhi, and finally the Supreme Court of India. Justice Dipak Misra has displayed exemplary erudition and remarkable fortitude since his elevation to the bench in the year 1996. As a judge, his gracious contribution to Indian jurisprudence has been on issues of constitutional significance, particularly with regard to civil liberties. I am sure that generations of academics, advocates, and judges will continue to engage with his scholarship long after we are gone. It is for this reason that I do not say farewell to Justice Misra today, but choose instead to celebrate the vision expressed in his judicial opinions. Jonathan Swift had once said, "Vision is the art of seeing the invisible." How do you do it? This is precisely the dilemma in which judges often find themselves. It is one thing to resolve legal disputes where answers are dictated by the statutory text or precedent. It is much more challenging when there are no given answers. In his years in the Supreme Court, Justice Misra has dealt with several cases that fall in the second category. In cases like Tehsin Poonawalla and Shakti Bahini, Justice Misra has spoken against social evils like mob lynching and honor killings, and denounced extra-legal attempts at dispensing justice. Individual liberty is a recurring motif in his judicial opinions. Justice Misra was a part of the Constitution bench of 9 judges that affirmed the right to privacy as inherent in the fundamental right to life and personal liberty. He has consistently upheld the freedom of the individual to choose and to express this choice. Recent cases like Shakti Bahini, Shafin Jahan, and more recent, Navdez Johar, involved the individual's liberty to choose and to express this choice in the form of a partner of whom society does not approve. In common cause, the choice extended to ending one's own life as an expression of dignity. Justice Misra has also supported women's rights to equal citizenship, evident in Charu Khurana, that outlawed gender-based criteria of membership in makeup associations, as well as in his outrage in the Nirbhaya case. His words have often sought to inspire nationalism among the people and reflect how deeply he venerates the Indian nation and its founders, such as in the National Anthem case and in Tujapurkar versus State of Maharashtra, where dealing with the prohibition of an obscene poem on Gandhiji. Under his able stewardship, not only has the Supreme Court maneuvered difficult legal questions in a dexterous manner, but it has also urged society to think progressively through the Constitution. Let me say a little more. It is perhaps trite to suggest that we live in times of great political churning across the world. Today, alongside a huge diversity of thought and opinion, there coexist conflicting worldviews. We are divided, perhaps more than ever, by lines of caste, class, gender, religion, and ideology. We are divided into infinitely variegated communities which crisscross along such lines to give us our special identity. What we should wear, what we should eat, what we should say, read, and think, these are no longer small and insignificant questions about our personal life. However, even as they give us identity and purpose and enrich the greatness of our democracy, these are issues that cut and divide us, and they make us hate and despise those who are different. The challenge then is to construct and protect a common world view that genuinely unifies us as a community. Where do we find such a shared vision? Doubtless in our constitution. I am therefore arguing for creation of a community of constitutional values. Belonging to this community does not mean that we must give up who we are, our personal beliefs and tastes. Instead, it means that we must constantly evaluate these beliefs on the touchstone of constitutional morality. Wherever there is doubt and conflict, we must allow constitutional morality to prevail. This is the true patriotism to the Constitution. I believe that profound constitutional questions can rarely be separated from the politically salient issues of the times. In fact, it is precisely in times like these that the resilience of our commitments are tested. I am taking the liberty of saying our commitment, because you and I are already part of this community. Surely we do not think that the constitutional text has ready-made answers, but we do believe that it offers the principles and procedures through which we can construct new answers suitable to our times. To paraphrase a great German philosopher, the constitutional worldview must prevail not because it is morally superior, but because it allows the most reasonable resolution of conflicts between other worldviews. Therefore, so long as we fail in this endeavor, we will continue to hate, despise, and kill each other. This reminds me of what late B.R. Ambedkar had once remarked. I quote, "I feel that the Constitution is workable. It is flexible, and it is strong enough to hold the country together, both in peacetime and in wartime. Indeed, if I may say so, if things go wrong under the new constitution, the reason will be not that we had a bad constitution, what we will have to say is that man was vile. I unquote. I hope that in the coming years we'll be able to construct such a culture. It is by no means a simple task and will require sustained collective effort. We must demystify and popularize the Constitution, its history and its prehistory, its agreements and its disagreements. We must teach to our young, not as a static body of norms, but as an evolving mode of collective as well as individual action and expression. What we need to strive for is a changed worldview that abides by constitutionalism as outlined above. And even though history may be the harshest judge of all, you and I must be the vanguard in this march, alert and empathic gatekeepers of justice. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me strike a personal note. Anybody who knows you, Chief Justice, knows that you are deeply inspired by the Bard of Avon. And because it is so, that I would like to quote just a sentence. Parting is such sweet sorrow that I shall say good night till it be morrow. Parting is a sweet sorrow indeed, Chief Justice, but we hope to have you around us. Thank you very much.